Today on the show, I am chatting with Nat Sheidley, CEO and president of Revolutionary Spaces in Boston. Nat and I chat about his childhood in rural Connecticut, his love of African history, the days he spent living in Cape Town, and his path into colonial American history. Then we delve into the importance of Crispus Attucks and why defining we the people is still as complicated today as it was in 1776. All of this and so much more, so stay tuned. Hi, everyone. This is Sandy Adams, and you're listening to a Southern Girls View podcast. Nat is the president and CEO of Revolutionary Spaces based in Boston, and Revolutionary Spaces comprises two of the most important buildings fundamental to America's birth, the Old State House and the Old South Meeting House, which we'll get into later. But Nat, welcome to the show today.
Thanks so much. I'm glad to be here.
So I always like to tell my listeners how we know each other, and this is actually the first time we've met. I was referred to you by my sister who lives up there in Boston, and she's worked with you somewhat on the old state house. She's been on the board there and done some things for you guys. So that's kind of how we got connected. But I love everything that you have been doing over the past few years, but especially with the rebranding that we're going to get into towards the latter part of the podcast today. But let's start off with what is your current job? And then I want to go back. Let's just talk about what your current job is first. And let's talk about that just briefly. And then we're going to go back to the beginning.
Sure. Yeah. So I'm president and CEO of a public history organization, which if you had asked me back, I don't know, when I was a kid, when I thought I wanted to be a veterinarian, I never in a million years would have thought that I was going to be. It's a fun job that combines my interest in history with an opportunity to make a real impact in our contemporary civic conversation.
Yes. And so you wanted to be a vet when you were a little kid. That's really cool.
Well, you know, there's that age where like, what are your choices? Like, I'm going to be an astronaut, I'm going to be a veterinarian, or I'm going to be, I don't know, my dad always said, like, strangely, I wanted to be a garbage collector. So I don't think that's a common one. But I had the vet thing in my head when I was a little kid.
So where did you grow up at?
I grew up in Storrs, Connecticut, which, you know, some people will have heard of Storrs because it's the place where the University of Connecticut is located. Other people look at me and they're like, you grew up in a store? I don't get it. but yeah, Storrs is where UConn is. My dad was a faculty member in the English department there.
Okay.
And so we moved there before my parents moved there before I was born. And it's not like the Connecticut that most people imagine when they think of Connecticut, because it's in the northeast corner of the state. It's very rural.
Okay. So you wanted to be a vet when you were little, but how did that transfer into your love of history, or was there a love of history when you were a little kid?
Yeah. I mean, I think I became interested in history really early on. I distinctly remember when I was in second grade, like checking out a book of Civil War uniforms from the library and bringing it home and giving it to my mom, who had taken time off to be, to be with me and my sister when we were little, but she was just starting back to graduate school in history when I was in elementary school. And so I think she must have been working on a research paper on the Civil War or something. I was like, oh, I'm going to give something to mom that's going to help her. But I think my interest in history was probably awakened first by watching how passionate my mom was about it. Right. And growing up in northeastern Connecticut, one of the few cultural organizations that was within striking distance was Old Sturbridge Village, which is, if you're not familiar with it, it's a sort of recreation of 1820s, 1830s era American village.
Okay.
It's sort of like colonial Williamsburg for the early Republic or from the antebellum period. And you can go there and like walk all around the village and go into the blacksmith shop. And I think I particularly love the general store where you get rock candy, which is basically like candy on a, like sugar on a string.
That's right.
That was always the highlight for me. But I think what I loved about going to Sturbridge Village was that it made it so palpable to me that the past was different and that you could live your life in a completely different way from the way that I was familiar with. And I just loved that. So I think, you know, history for me was really about, it was about being awakened to the variety of human experience in different times and different places.
Right.
And then, you know, that was deepened for me when I was in high school, when I had an opportunity to be an exchange student for a year in Germany.
We talked about that. Yes.
I lived with a German family. And I think it, in a very different way, was awakened to the possibility that people could think differently, could have different cultural expectations, could have different assumptions. And I think for me, you know, a sort of through line in all of my in all of my work and all the things that have interested me in my life is that sort of the challenge of communicating across that barrier, whether it's a cultural barrier or a different set of expectations formed by looking at two different periods in time, how do you translate across that? How do you find the common human experience that is the same, whether you're in one place or another? What is the constant there? And history to me is like that. It's an act of translation across that boundary of time.
It is. Was that the first time you'd ever been overseas when you did the exchange program?
It was the first time I was outside of North America. My family did not have a lot of money to travel, but I do remember going to French Canada. I distinctly remember going to Lac Mégantic and ordering something in French, which my parents had met each other in France when they were in college. And so they were really excited to be able to talk to the waiter in French. But yes, going to Germany was really a revelation for me because I really had not had a chance to travel at all.
So before you went there, did you have any preconceived notions? Because I think the portion that you went to had been Western Germany, right?
Yeah, that's right.
Did you have any?
I was in a little town outside of the city of Hanover.
Okay. When you got back, did you have any, did it change your perspective other than that on just that you wanted to travel more, you wanted to be farther outside of where you were currently living?
Well,
I know, so I threw a
first
question.
Of all, I think it gave me a set of questions that I probably still struggle to answer. Okay. I wouldn't say I came back with any kind of revelation other than the revelation that comes from looking at your own culture through an outsider's eyes. And realizing that all of the things that you take for granted and that you assume are just like, this is the way the world is, suddenly turn out not to be things that should be assumed. And so I think for me, it opened up a whole world of possibility, like a whole lot of things to question and interrogate. I remember stepping off the plane after being away for a year, and we came back through Washington, D.C. because it was the scholarship, the exchange program I was on was sponsored by Congress and the German Bundestag. So when coming back, we had to be debriefed by our Congress people, which was kind of cool. But I remember getting off the plane and like the first thing I noticed was, oh my gosh, it's hot and humid.
Right.
You don't get that in the part of Germany where I was. The second thing was driving from the airport to where we were staying was like, oh my God, look at these gigantic cars. Nobody in Germany drives a gigantic car like this. What are we doing? And then like, oh boy, it's really dirty. And, you know, I mean, just like the things that are based on appearance. But I think I applied those same insights to my interpersonal connections and just realizing that like, oh, the way that Americans interact with each other is not necessarily the way that everybody interacts with each other.
Right. I think when I was in Germany, the biggest thing I noticed, well, there were a lot of things, but the most out there thing was that we all wore color and everybody else wore dark colors. And we very much stood out. But right, yeah, there were
did you go to Berlin, maybe?
I did. Yeah, I was
that
right.
That sounds about like Berlin.
I was right outside of Berlin, and there were five of us women, and we stuck out like we had a huge sign on our forehead that says they're American.
No, and that's totally the case. And Cindy, I remember, so I was there in 1984, 85, right? So this was before the reunification, the wall was still up. And yes, when my high school class in Germany took a week's trip to Berlin, and went over to East Germany, I remember sitting in East Berlin at an outdoor cafe and looking around and being like, wow, this is really a different world. I mean, even color, like there wasn't black, like everything was gray. And it's fascinating the way that just the appearance of things makes so real to you how different everything can be. And it's ultimately at the level of how people think, how people interact with each other, what they assume. That's where difference really lies. But we index it by outward differences.
Sure. I was there 10 years after the wall came down. And even then, I could very much tell, a lot of the things that were being held over that was just in their personalities and had been bred, especially in the older people. Let's move on into your college days. And I wanted to talk to you about your folk, because you in your undergraduate, I think that's where you did your honors thesis, was your undergrad.
Yeah.
And you did it on South Africa. So let's talk a little bit, like, how did you get from rural Connecticut? Like, how did that, I obviously can see your mom's influence with her history concentration, but how did you get from rural Connecticut to college where you want to go, and you lived in South Africa, correct?
Yeah. I mean, so I don't know that I have a good explanation for it, but I think, again, I think the through line is a real interest in difference and a real interest in cultural boundaries and how people communicate across them. So I don't think I set out to explore African history per se, but I took a course on African history from a fantastic professor at the school where I was an undergraduate. And I think I just recognized that where the literature about African history was at was really taking seriously the point of view of African peoples as they navigated a world of European conquest and colonization.
Right.
And a lot of that literature resolved to the challenges of understanding people with a very different set of assumptions from you, but took seriously both sides of the equation, which an earlier generation of historians who had a very imperial or colonial frame didn't take seriously, right?
Like
we understand what the Europeans were after, and that's the story we're going to tell, but it feels totally different if you tell it from the perspective of African people. The other thing that led me down that path was just an interest in that was the time of, I mean, there was a lot of politics at American universities that time around apartheid. And I got very involved in the anti-apartheid organizing at Stanford, where I was an undergraduate. And so I think it was a natural, so first I was studying East African history. I studied Swahili for 3 or 4 years in college. And Tanzania was occupied by Germany, so my German language skills came in handy. But I think I was drawn to South Africa because I wanted to understand the roots of that system of inequality, of apartheid. Where did that come from? How did it get baked into the institutions of a nation in a way that allowed it to survive into the second half of the 20th century? So I wrote about the end of slavery in the 1830s in the colony at the Cape of Good Hope, what would become the Cape, Cape Town. But I think what I was really interested in was how did the structures of inequality that had been present during slavery get transported into the post-slavery world? What did, what did, how did inequality get reconstituted after the end of slavery?
Right. And you chose to go and live there for some time in order to work on this?
Yeah, I was really lucky to get a research grant, an undergraduate research grant from an endowed fund at Stanford, which made it possible for me to go live in Cape Town for 3 months. I probably, if I had it to do over again, wouldn't choose to go and research in the Southern Hemisphere during the summer, because it was like I went a year and a half between summers because it was winter when I was in Cape Town, or whatever passes for winter in Cape Town. But I lived right downtown at the there was a YMCA, which was like the only place in downtown Cape Town where people classed as Africans or as colored could live. So there were migrant workers living there. So I had the opportunity to live with them, take meals with them. You know, there were people from Namibia and all over the southern half of Africa. And that was really, interesting. And then I just walked across the street to go to the archives. But in some ways, what was really interesting to me, and I think it informed my academic work, was what was happening in the streets and in the churches at that time, right? I was a short walk away from the church that was Bishop Tutu's church, and, you know, was present for not a small number of protests that ended up with water cannon being sprayed into the crowd. You know, I was never very close to the action, but I, you know, that was to me as important as what was in the archives in understanding the history, right? Because that was, if history is an act of translation between past and present, knowing what the present looked like in South Africa was just as important as knowing what was in the archival records that I was looking at.
Sure. And plus you're getting to see history happen as it is. Like, what year were you over there?
It would have been the summer of 1989.
I mean, that's pretty amazing that you were over there and you're right, experiencing what's going on in the street and just kind of seeing everything. Did you get any pushback because you were white living in the colored section?
Not as much pushback as I got for considering going. So I, you know, I was friends with a lot of South African exiles back in California where I was an undergraduate. And there was, in the anti-apartheid movement, there was sort of a prohibition on travel in, you know, one was really discouraged from going and supporting the economy of South Africa by being a tourist. So I had to talk through with folks at great length the value of the work, right? If the work itself is a tool for telling the story of inequality and getting people to think differently about the structures of inequality today, then maybe it's valid. I felt very welcomed by the African community in South Africa. And I just managed to keep at arm's length most of the rest of Cape Town at the time. So, but it's a beautiful city. One of the things I would love to do is get back there because I know it's changed. It's just like going back to Germany after the fall of the wall. It was a totally different world, right? And going back to South Africa now. One of our board members spends time there every year and I've enjoyed talking with her about what she's seen.
Well, that's I find that very fascinating because you're right. It's you're there experiencing the history, and that's just really so. That wasn't so. Let's get into your PhD because you chose to go live in Tennessee for your PhD or to work on it. So, of course, I'm from Tennessee, so I was fascinated about this guy from rural Connecticut who spends time in South Africa, and yet his dissertation is about the Tennessee area. So let's First, tell us what the title is and then how you chose that subject.
Oh boy, can I even remember the title of my dissertation?
I don't have it written down either.
Yeah, well, I know that the title was Unruly Men. And yes. Really, the dissertation was an exploration of the period of conquest and colonization and then the aftermath of sort of English-speaking settlers moving into the Tennessee River Valley. Right. And how the native people, Cherokee and Muscogee Indians, responded to that. And, you know, that was a far cry from African history.
It was, yes.
So when I started graduate school, when did I start graduate school? I took a few years off after I finished my undergraduate work. I worked as a bike messenger, of all things. And then when I got tired of riding around in the streets of San Francisco, I decided I better get back to the library. But I did not think I was going to study Native American history and colonial and revolutionary American history. It just wasn't part of my plan.
Right.
I thought I was going to expand on the work I'd done on African history by looking at post-emancipation race relations in transnational contexts, looking at the aftermath of slavery in Africa and in the Americas.
Which sounds perfectly plausible, yes.
It seemed like a great theory.
Yeah.
And, you know, I mean, I think one of the things that I've learned from all the various turns that I've taken in my life, I just like, it's good to always maintain some part of you that's open to serendipity, right?
Yes,
because you just never know what kind of opportunity may be there. And if you don't open the door and walk through it, you miss out, right? So at any rate, early in my graduate coursework, I was like, oh, geez, I never took any courses on American history. I probably should not have that gap.
Which is funny compared to considering what you do now.
Well, right. who would have guessed? Anyhow, I certainly didn't guess. But yeah, so I was like, I probably should take a seminar on colonial America because that's where American history began and I should get up to speed on it. But what was new in American history at that time was taking seriously what the colonial period might have looked like through the eyes of indigenous people.
Right.
So Americanists were just getting around to realizing, oh, right, English colonists were not the only people in North America. And you could tell the story from the perspective of Native peoples. And what would that mean? But they were just beginning down that road. And, you know, I'd spent a lot of time really digging into African history, where scholars for a generation and a half had been grappling with these questions in really sophisticated ways. Like, how can you tell the story from the perspective of African people if in many cases they didn't leave a written record of early contact and of their experiences and responses to European conquest, and had a very sophisticated way of approaching that problem and taking seriously oral sources and so forth. Americanists hadn't even gotten to figuring out what the questions were to ask. So I was like, oh, this sounds really familiar. And I have a whole set of questions that I could take to this material that might open it up in ways that would help. So I just started off on that tangent and never came back, basically.
Obviously, yeah. So, you know, we briefly, is I wanted to know what it was like, because how long did you live in Tennessee to do your research?
Well, living in Tennessee, so I spent a year traveling around to all the archives that would give me the information I needed to write the dissertation, which was, you know, a lot of it was missionary records, the records of missionaries living among the Cherokee and Creek Indians, but then there was also a whole body of, so the dissertation involved the religious revivals that happened in both in English-speaking communities and in Native American communities, and trying to understand whether those were part of a common phenomenon. Did they have the same roots, or were they just completely separate, which is the way they were being treated by historians at the time? So I had to go look at the records of Baptist and Methodist and Presbyterian congregations all over East Tennessee. And I'm sorry, I forgot
That's
to
okay.
move my phone out.
That's okay. My dog barked and your phone rang. We're even now.
Right. Well, at any rate, so what I did was I spent 2 months here, 2 months there. I did a little bit of research totally out of the region in Michigan, where there was a body of source material. And then I was in North Carolina, especially in Winston-Salem.
Right.
And then I spent like 3 months in Knoxville, and I spent probably 2 to 3 months in Nashville, maybe longer, okay. Working at the Tennessee Library there. So I don't know, all told, it was like 6 to 8
months,
something
like
that.
It's a lot of time though. And when I was prepping you for the questions, you're like, I don't know what I can, like, I don't know what I'm going to say about, like, and I really didn't want, because Tennessee is different from Connecticut, but then
totally.
You grew up in a rural setting and, you know, in some aspects, East Tennessee is very rural. So in some ways there probably wasn't a lot of difference, but, were there any significant things that you just saw that were completely different from where you lived?
Well, you know, I loved Tennessee, and I still do. And I would love to be able to go back and spend more time.
You're welcome
there.
Here anytime.
So a couple of things come to mind. Number one, it's such a beautiful state. I rented a space overlooking the Tennessee River in Knoxville.
Wow.
And I still remember waking up and seeing like the mist rising off the river, and you know, those distinctive sort of round hills in that part of East Tennessee. I mean, it's gorgeous. And then, you know, Nashville's so that's one thing, is just the richness of the land itself and how pleasing it is to the eye.
Right.
Like I can see how people want to stay and enjoy it. But then also the diversity of the state, right? I mean, Nashville's a totally different world from Knoxville and from all the rural communities in between. You know, it's a very cosmopolitan city.
Right.
I lived in Germantown, in a fantastic late 19th century house that I was able to rent a room in, and you know, the whole country music scene and Vanderbilt, and like there's so much cool stuff in Nashville. But I, you know, I think one of the takeaways for me, and it helped with my, right, so I was spending my time in the 1780s and 1790s when I was in the archives, right?
Right.
And one of the takeaways for me is just that, like, it's so much easier to understand the experience of people who you're reading about if you can walk outside and see the land that they walked on. It's just like part of the work of history is an imaginative act, no less so than the act of translating across cultural boundaries. That's an imaginative act too. You have to be able to imagine what the world looks like seen through somebody else's eyes.
Right.
And there's something about the power of being in a place and of seeing the thing that others saw that just supports that leap, that makes that human connection. You can imagine like, oh, right, this is, I would have been seeing the same thing.
Yes.
And I think that was powerful in its own way.
No, I totally agree with you, especially, you know, in East Tennessee, you know, you go into some areas that are probably look exactly like they did 100, 200 years ago, except maybe the woods were not as thick. But yeah, you know, I was, no matter where I go, if people have been on that land or in those areas for really long periods of time, I stop and go, you know, I'm walking in these footsteps of people from so many generations. And it really just is an incredible feeling about that. So now let's talk about, you were teaching at Wellesley College, and what propelled you then? Because I get a lot of questions from people, and I actually had the same issue about is there any jobs out there for people with history degrees? And there are, and they can go into a wide variety of different jobs, not just teaching. But what suddenly propelled you into, I want to teach now? Or was that your only obvious answer?
Well, so one doesn't set off down the, I want to get a PhD path without, well, at least at the time that I did, without conceiving of, I'm going to be a university professor.
That's
and
right.
And I think in some ways I was just guilty of not being super creative because I grew up in an academic family. My dad was an English professor. My mom went back to graduate school.
Sure.
And by the time I was in graduate school, she was teaching in a, you know, in a college program in Colorado. So I was like, what else do people do? They become college professors, right? but I also was passionate about the, you know, the scholarly project. I think the you know, in interrogating the records in order to understand better the how we got to where we are today feels like a really satisfying way to spend one's time. So I felt really privileged to get an academic job at Wellesley College. And in some ways, you know, like I always tell people who are considering getting academic, going down the academic career path, like you need to understand it's like the army, you know, you could be posted to Alaska and you're like, I love Alaska. I'm going, you know, so I just got lucky that I ended up with a job at Wellesley College. And, you know, I loved that work, but there was always a little part of me that felt like, oh, well, I quite found the thing that I'm called to do. There's like, there's something that I am still seeking here. And so I spent some time exploring what that might be, even as I was teaching and really loving the work of teaching Wellesley students.
So were you teaching like first and second year students, or were you teaching the higher level students?
So in the department that I was in, so the Wellesley, I don't know if it's the same way now, but at that time when I started there at the very beginning of 1999, there were three Americanists, and we sort of divided the curriculum into, like, you know, so we each taught everything to all levels for our section of the history. So I was asked to create the curriculum in Native American history, and then I taught all the colonial and revolutionary courses, and I taught the first half of the U.S. survey up through the Civil War. I taught all levels. So, like, I taught an advanced seminar in Native American history, and then the course I always enjoyed teaching most was a course about gender, because my work had been about changing gender roles too. So I taught a course called The Historical Construction of American Manhood
That's pretty cool.
So I always had to give a disclaimer on the first day of class, like, I will not be asked to speak for all men. Sorry.
Right.
but I can help you ask questions of the sources to get answers to your questions.
So what was the hardest thing about teaching maybe the younger, like the freshman and sophomore? Did you see people in class because if history is not going to be their major, they're not as invested in the classes. So did you have any problem with teaching people that were not on the history path, maybe?
You know, I mean, there's all kinds of pedagogical challenges involved with teaching any subject. I think, you know, one of the things I discovered early on was that I had to help people understand that history isn't just a collection of dates and events. Because I think, I don't know, without getting into why, I mean, maybe it's bound up with our current testing regime or something, but for some reason, I mean, there are fantastic middle school and high school history teachers, but I think many students seem to come through those years with an expectation that, like, I just got to memorize what happened, as though, like, it's objective, which, of course, based on my prior comments, is not the way I see history. It's an interpretive act, right?
And no, I totally agree with you. I was a judge at National History Day competitions based at the University of Maryland.
Oh, cool.
And when I told people that I was doing that, because I had done it, I'd actually participated when I was in high school and junior high. And when I told people I was going there to do it, I got a lot of people were like, how do you judge multiple choice? Like that's the questions. And I'm like, okay, there's websites, there's documentaries, there's, you know, projects. And they're like, on what? And I'm like, on questions, like, but it still makes me laugh today. And it's also very sad that so many people out there, you're right, that's what they think history is. And I'm like, it's so much more than that. It's probably the most well-rounded subject for how it you know, chooses to engage the student, in my opinion.
I'm a big fan of the Harry Potter books. I loved reading them with my kids, but it always was a little painful that the most boring class was the history, you know, the history of wizarding class. They all are like, oh my God.
And I would have loved.
The master's always like just giving a list of dates and, you know, events. Yes. Like, no, do more than that. Because yes, you're right. I think in many ways, it is a well-rounded discipline. And, you know, one of the things that I worked with students on is understanding that it's an interpretive enterprise inherently. Sure. You can take the same set of facts and the same materials and come up with an entirely different understanding of what it adds up to. Sure. And there's also all kinds of transferable skills, you know, that are rooted in how we read sources and how we contextualize them, that, you know, you can learn in history classes and apply in all kinds of different walks of life.
Okay. So let's fast forward now. You worked at the Bostonian Society. So let's tell everybody what the Bostonian Society was, and then let's move into how you guys rebranded.
Yeah.
And I believe it was the start of this year when you officially rebranded.
Okay. Yeah, well, we merged. The Bostonian Society, it's a particularly stuffy name. it was created in 1881 by a group of Bostonians who were concerned that the unique materials for the study of Boston's history and the things that basically, as Boston Brahmins, made them important in the world were becoming lost. And maybe we should make sure they're saved, and then we should tell people about how important we are. It was founded with that purpose. And it also was very early on, it got involved in the preservation of Boston's Old State House.
Right.
So the Old State House was the seat of provincial government at the time of the revolution. So all of those conversations about how people should have a voice in government and about how Americans should be represented, many of them, those conversations first took shape in the Old State House. But in the late 1870s and early 1880s, Boston was considering like, well, maybe we don't need the Old State House. It's just kind of in the way, and we should tear it down or move it somewhere else and redevelop the neighborhood. So the Bostonian Society partly was formed to ensure that that wouldn't happen. And, you know, it's operated ever since as a public history organization in Boston, and operated the Old State House as one of the main sites on the Freedom Trail.
Right.
So I got involved. Sorry, Sandy. I tend to talk. but I got involved through my students at Wellesley, who I had a couple of students who were asked to get involved in writing content for a web-based project that the Bostonian Society was doing. And because I was their supervisor on an independent study project, I got involved too. And I was invited to be part of the creative team. And that little piece of me that was always like, I'm not quite sure if being an academic historian is the right thing for me. In the context of that sort of creative team meeting, I was like, oh, I really like public history. This is cool. And so that was a few years before I ended up at the Bostonian Society, but it did start me on a path of thinking my way out of being an academic and into being a public historian.
I did want to make a note for those out there that don't know or have never been to Boston. So the Old State House is in the midst of all of these brand new, you know, sparkly, tall buildings around it. And you've got this really old colonial state house. And the balcony, because it's two-story, correct? two-story with a bell tower, maybe? No.
Well, it's, yeah, I mean, there's a, yeah, it's two main floors, okay. A third floor where committees used to do their work, and then there's a tower. Yeah.
Okay. But the balcony is where the Declaration of Independence was read, correct?
Yep. The balcony was where, when the Declaration finally made it to Boston on July 18th of 1776, it was first read to the people of Boston, who had only recently booted the British out of town just a few months earlier and were still coming back and reestablishing themselves there.
And when we talk about balcony, it's not like a huge balcony. It's a small balcony. But yeah, and it's still there and it's a beautiful building. I've never toured it. So the next time I come to Boston, I'm going to.
Oh, you totally have to.
Yes.
Like if you go up in the tower, I want to take you up in the tower, and you know, there are very few places where you can see the original beams in the building, but there's a place in the tower where you can look right up at the beams holding up the cupola and see where the joiner who built the tower marked each beam, right? Each beam had to be marked with a number because it was assembled on the ground, and then they took it apart and rebuilt it up on top of the building. And you can see the maker's marks on it, which is, it's like,
that's
just
really
that, like
cool.
The immediacy of, oh, right, human beings lived then and they built this. And wow, that just changes my way of thinking about it. It really comes through when you look at those.
So what was the date that the structure was actually built?
So it opened for business in 1713. So it was built to replace an older townhouse that had burned. It was made of wood and it burned in a fire in 1711.
That's pretty cool. I mean, that's just really cool. I don't, you know, the one thing that I, when I was in Europe, the one thing that I was just so amazed at is there was so many structures that were hundreds and thousands of years old. And we just don't necessarily have that here, especially the farther out west you go, the less you have those type of structures. But even like in New England, you don't have structures that are thousands of years old. And it's just, it really is amazing when you do get to see these structures that, you know, are even 200 or 300 years old or even 400. But yeah, it's just really cool.
Yeah, well, you have to go to Native American sites to see structures that are 1,000 years old. And there are some in this country. But yeah, it's the old State House is the oldest surviving public building from all of the British colonies in North America, which is kind of cool.
Right. Okay, so let's talk about the rebranding. So, and I kind of knew a little bit about it from my sister talking, but let's just talk about why you guys decided to join the two buildings and rebrand. What was the whole purpose in the rebranding?
Right. So, Revolutionary Spaces is actually a new organization, and it was formed through the merger of the Bostonian Society and another organization, Old South Association in Boston, which had been created actually a few years before the Bostonian Society to preserve Old South Meeting House from being torn down. And so it had operated for all those years, a sister site just a few blocks up Washington Street from the Old State House. So Old South Meeting House was the place where the meeting that would become the Boston Tea Party took place.
Okay.
That's why it's best known. And it was a church, but also it was the largest indoor gathering place in Boston. So a place where popular politics happened. So we at the Bostonian Society, we were thinking about, you know, how can we make the deepest impact through this site and people's encounter with this site? And one of the things that we grappled with was that the building only tells half a story, because it was the place where elected representatives did their work.
Right.
But those elected representatives were in dialogue with people out of doors, as they were called at the time, people who were advocating for change through protest, through public meetings, through their votes, even though a minority of Bostonians could vote in the 18th century. And it felt to us that, you know, one of the problems that both organizations were grappling with was that, you know, we couldn't tell the larger story. Mm-hmm. Of the push and pull between popular and elite politics, between the formal and informal, between ordinary people and those they choose to represent them. So, you know, we felt like maybe there was an opportunity to put the stories together and to tell them across these two sites. And I really believe that by bringing them together in one common visitor experience, we have created a cultural resource that is unlike any other in the country. There are no two sites with the significance to our nation's founding that these two have that capture both sides of that tension that was the engine that led to the American Revolution.
Right.
And Sandy, importantly, that tension didn't go away with the revolution, right? We created a new system of government and we created a revolution settlement that said like, oh, this is how it's going to be. But it didn't put an end to the push and pull between the will of the people and those who represent them. Like that's still the thing that drives our politics today. And those questions that took shape in the old State House and Old South Meeting House and across the two sites, they're still the main questions we grapple with as Americans today, right?
Like, right.
Who speaks for me? Right. How does my voice get to be heard? You know, if I'm silenced, what do I do about it? And I, you know, to me, most importantly, the two sites really frame a question that we are struggling with as Americans, which is when we say that people should have a voice in their own government, whose voices are we saying we're going to count, right? So we get this, we get these words, we the people, from the revolutionary generation, but we don't get a, like a decoder ring that says who we adds up to. Like, who are we? And that, like, you can, I think you can make a reasonable argument that the ultimate arc of American history is our conversation about that question. Right.
Yes, I agree.
So when we put the organizations and the buildings together, our goal was to say, look, we have a unique contribution to make, not just to our understanding of the past, but to that conversation we are still having today. We can bring people together in these places where these questions were born so they can feel the power of place and feel like, wow, people sacrificed to give me the opportunity to continue the work of democracy today and to inspire them to do it, right? So our vision of public history is it's not just about the past. It's a set of tools we give to people to make change for the future.
Sure. No, I absolutely agree with that. So let's talk about, you know, at the beginning of the year, you guys rebranded and joined, merged the two organizations, and you had a plan for 2020. I'm sure you had a plan. Everybody had a plan for 2020. And then March happened and COVID hit. And how did that, I mean, I'm guessing you guys immediately shut down like mid-March. I think that's when most people shut down mid-March. So then, like, what was that thought process of okay, what are we going to do now?
Right. Well, first of all, you know, we had the great foresight. Part of our merger was to recruit a whole new cohort of board members, right? We took some board members from each organization, and then we recruited six new board members because we wanted some group of people who weren't just looking at the new organization through the lens of the organizations that it was created. And one of the new people that we recruited is Asaf Bitan, who's the head of this fantastic public history public health organization and healthcare research organization, Ariadne Labs, here in Massachusetts, who spent 20 years working in the field of, you know, public health and pandemic preparedness. So,
oh my God,
while we were grappling with, oh my gosh, can we remain open? You know, so I was like, well, I know it's not why you recruited me, but let me help you.
Let me put my skill. So like, that's pretty funny.
But yes, we closed on March 12th, which was exactly 1 week after we brought everyone together to essentially launch the new organization the 250th commemoration of the Boston Massacre, right? We had the governor of Massachusetts and the mayor of Boston and the police commissioner and the president of the NAACP Boston branch all there on March 5th to help us talk about how the memory of the massacre is bound up with our understanding of who we are today and who we want to be tomorrow. And then a week later, we're like, yeah, sorry, we got to shut down. But yeah, I mean, our plans for this year were to make a huge investment in creating the visibility that any new organization needs. And let me tell you, when we were drawing up our plan, we did not put like, oh yeah, and let's make sure we launch a new organization in a pandemic year.
That's right.
on the list. So it's been a challenge. One of the strengths of our organization is that it's, you know, we have two sites on the Freedom Trail, and, you know, a million people a year walk the Freedom Trail. So there's a lot of opportunity to reach visitors, and, you know, we usually can count on high admissions, like high levels of visitation, you know, and sales in our gift shop. And a lot of that supports the work of the organization. So we lost all that this year. And we lost the visibility that we were planning to create through a big public art project that we had planned and two new plays that we were going to share with the public. But, you know, we've tried to practice our value of adaptability, because I think to do the work that we want to do, which is to be a resource for contemporary civic conversation, means constantly being adaptable and not being too fixed in your ways. So we've tried to move as much of our programming to a virtual platform as possible.
And I've been very, because I do follow you guys on Instagram. I've been very impressed with, you know, you changing things up and constantly getting things out. And I've been very impressed with that. How have you used these opportunities for all of the school age kids home in Boston? Like, how did, like, was that part of the adaptable plan, where how can we help engage kids that maybe are homeschooled now and can't go into the classroom?
Well, so a couple of things on that. Number one, yes, I mean, it's useful whenever you've got something unexpected that happens or a new challenge to look for, like, where's the opportunity here? Right. So one of the opportunities that comes from being forced into a virtual space is that you can reach folks who you might not have reached before. And so we've been very alert to that. Our plan this year was really to target adult audiences primarily. And so we haven't invested a huge amount in school age, in reaching school age audiences initially, but that is a big priority for us in the next 6 to 9 months. But, you know, we now have regular attendees in our program at our programs from all over the country, and folks who have become members who are, you know, they in a million years wouldn't have been aware of a, you know, a panel that we were having or a virtual play or whatever the case might be. But I do think that there's a need out there for virtual curricular experiences as well. So we've done a range of different things. We had one teacher from Ohio contact us and ask if he could come and broadcast to his class live from Old South Meeting House.
Awesome.
Got in the car and he drove overnight to Boston and did all of his AP US history teaching the following day from inside the building where the Tea Party first,
I think that is amazing though.
And we wouldn't normally be able to do that, right? Because normally we're open all day long every day. So we were closed and we could offer the space, but there's a lot more that we can do. So we've got our programming staff is working with a teacher advisory committee right now to design virtual curriculum. And, you know, in theory, right? I mean, there are classrooms all over the country that are where students are learning about the revolution. They're learning about the Tea Party. They're learning about the massacre. We have a great opportunity to reach them if we have a good product.
And make it more real than just reading something in a book, because, you know, they may not be able to go there, but to even, like, for him to broadcast from there says, you know, this place is real and it still exists and this is what happens. And it's when you make those things a little bit more real to the kids, then they can kind of understand. And then you relate it back to the questions that are going out today and questions people ask today. You know, it was something interesting. I lived in Houston for almost 16 years and I had to learn more about Texas history than I ever wanted to know. But the other thing that I also didn't realize, because I tutored a lady who was taking Texas history, I didn't realize that Texas had six constitutions. But the you talk about conversations today and questions that people ask today, going back in history as well. And, you know, there's still talk from people that talk about seceding from the Union, which you would never hear in any other state. But because of that was Texas's history, you know, there's still questions that Texas had that they're still proposing today that are a little different from other states. But you go back to the questions we ask way back then are still questions we ask today, is very true no matter what the year is. I think there's still those very valid questions that get people's attention and still part of the conversation. You mentioned so let's talk about, first, are there any book recommendations that you have for Boston, for American history, or American Revolution or Bostonian history?
You're asking not for scholarly treatises.
No.
But like books that feel relatively accessible. Yeah, I mean,
for like the everyday person who doesn't care that much about history.
Yeah. I mean, I think one of the nice things is that a lot of historians have been working recently to reach a wider audience and to be less specialized. And so some fantastic historians who do really great, super specialized work for, you know, the 100 other historians who really care about their work are also writing books for a much wider audience that are accessible. A couple of works that I've enjoyed recently that I think your listeners might be interested in are Jane Kamensky, who is a historian at Harvard, who wrote a book called A Revolution in Color. I think it came out in 2016, if I'm remembering correctly. So it's a few years old now, but not very old. And it's a biography of John Singleton Copley, who, he's famous as, you know, one of the great early American painters. But in her story, putting him at the center of the story of the revolution is an opportunity to help people understand just how complex it was, right? Because we read back from our own time, from our own expectations and from our mythology that like, oh, it was us against them. It's like all the Americans, of course, were patriots and all the British, but like it was a civil war. And a lot of people just wanted things to stay the way they were. And they didn't want to see the old world fall apart. And Copley has a really complicated pathway through it. But I think it helps people understand just how complicated and conflicted the time period was, and helps to sort of widen the lens so we can see a much richer palette of colors, is her metaphor for it. Another book, and this much more recent, just came out this year on the 250th anniversary of the Boston Massacre, is my friend Serena Zabin, who is a professor at Carleton College, wrote a really great book called The Boston Massacre, A Family History.
I've seen that, and I've got that on my list to read. Yeah,
it's a great read, and you know, she captures for us a really intimate picture of what it was like to live in Boston at a pivotal moment, and just, you know, at a very detailed level, how deeply interwoven the lives of Bostonians and British soldiers became right before everything got ripped apart. And it's kind of cool book to just gives you a completely different perspective on things. And I was trying to think of like, are there good historical novels? Because I think sometimes like that.
I saw one, it's about John Adams. Didn't he do the trial that had to do with someone in the Boston Massacre?
He represented the soldiers.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, you're right. A good, I'm forgetting the author's name, but yeah, a book recently came out on Adams and the trial. And of course, you know, there's a lot of great writing about the sort of the people who when we say the founders, the folks who come to mind, right? I mean, there's the Chernow's biography of Hamilton, which is what sort of gave the inspiration for the musical. And there's, you know, there's the book about John Adams. And like, I mean, there's a lot. There's Nathaniel Philbrick is doing a 3-part series on George Washington, which I love his writing. But I don't know if you've ever run across these novels. They're young adult novels, but they're really fantastic historical fiction set. They're by Laurie Hals Anderson, mm-hmm. and they're set in the Revolution, but the action really follows a young girl who's born in bondage in Jersey and like finds her way out.
Right.
The first one in the series, I think, is called Chains.
Okay.
And then the second one is called Forge, and the third one is called Ashes. And they're fantastic. They really capture the human dimension of right. it. And I think that's a big challenge.
It is.
Because this is a period that's so saturated in mythology that we lose the humanity. We forget right. that these were human beings. They're like two-dimensional cardboard characters. And, you know, they're like perfect. They gave us everything. And right. like, but that's not, of course, they were human beings struggling to navigate a world that was falling apart around them and
that's right.
made a lot of mistakes.
Yes. So, you know, and I'm sure most historians, I don't know how you feel about the miniseries or the TV series Turn, Washington Spies.
I'm laughing because I'm on early in season 3 right now. I got sucked into it recently. I had studiously avoided it.
Okay, so, and I know that it took, you know, some liberties in there, but I watched it a few years ago when I was actually in the DC area to do the History Day judging. And I went up there like 2 or 3 days in advance so I could tour around. But my sister got me into watching it. So I watched like back to back. And I had never, I know I am embarrassed to say this, I had never really gotten into like the battles of the Revolutionary War. That was really just not my passion. But after watching that series, it actually connected some things, like especially Benedict Arnold. He was just never someone I paid attention to. But it also then just kind of, it made everything more understandable. And I don't know, I just developed this obsession now with the Revolutionary War. Like I'm obsessed, even with the battle sites. And, you know, I know there are people out there that say, when, you know, it wasn't really, there wasn't a lot of, you know, they took liberties in there and all this kind of stuff. But I also think that if you can create those series or that type of programming that gets the average person more interested, I think then that's a good thing. You know, I know that there are people out there that true historians that are like, well, I don't, you know, it's not really a lot of fact in there. There's a lot of fiction. But I think that if it engages the ordinary person to understand our history a little bit more, I think that's a good thing. But I'm obsessed. Like I didn't know Syntocket, New York, like, or Long Island had like, I never knew it was a hotbed of like the spy industry.
Right. Well, it's an amazing story, right?
And it is.
It's you know, and yes, of like with any work of, you know, fictional.
Right.
Whatever, you know, if it's theater or TV or movies or writing, I mean, there's always going to be some liberties taken, but I think, you know, in many cases, those liberties are taken in an effort to get the reader to
right.
engage. And
right.
then secondly, sometimes in order to help people with the work of
sure.
translation, right? Because
sure.
if you don't know all of the assumptions and expectations of that world, then we need to
right.
do some translating to help people access it. But I think it's a pretty compelling story, and it certainly does bring to life some of the less well-known aspects of
yes.
early America. I mean, there's, you know, I think you get a good feel for how divisive things were and how complicated it was that family members could be on different sides of the
right.
conflict. We get a little bit of a window onto slavery, which I think is often revelatory for American
right.
audiences to conceive of the fact that slavery was part of the world of the Revolution, even in New Jersey and New
right.
York and New England, that this was a fact of life, and that when people talked about freedom, they did it in a context where they were also, you know, there were
right.
people enslaved in their midst. So
I love how it really shows you that. I think sometimes we forget, like you said earlier, we forget that those people were human, but that the fact that they were risking their lives for what they believed in or what they thought was going to be a better way of life. And I think that's really important for people to understand that, you know, they did, and a lot of them gave their lives for what they thought was going to be a better one, but every day was a risk to all of them. And they were ordinary people doing amazing things that they didn't think was amazing at the time. Yep. You know, and I think most people don't when they're in the midst of doing stuff. Let's fast forward then really quickly, and we're going to wrap up with Cyprus Atticus. Is that how you say it?
Crispus Attucks.
Crispus Atticus, right?
Attucks.
Attucks. I just
Attucks.
Really...
Well, it was a Native American name, so okay. It's a Native American word.
So let's talk about who he was and why he's important, a part of your programming this year.
Yeah. So Crispus Attucks was one of the people who was one of the Bostonians who was killed at the Boston Massacre in March of 1770. You know, he's an interesting character. So there were five people who died in the streets just outside the old state house that night. And they're lifted up as martyrs to the nation not yet formed, to the cause of liberty. And Attucks is interesting because he's a person of color. He's of mixed African and Native American descent, appears to have been born into bondage in the town of Framingham, not far outside of Boston, had liberated himself as a young man in the early 1750s, and had made his life at sea as part of this complex, raucous world wow. of mariners in the 18th century Atlantic. You know, he had a home down in the Caribbean, and he
oh, wow.
came through Boston, and probably he spent time in ports of call on the other side of the Atlantic. So he's through Attucks, we can see how rich and varied the human experience of early America really was.
Right.
But he also reminds us that, you know, there were enslaved people in New England, and there were Native people struggling for their rights. So we've tried to organize our programming this year around the 250th anniversary of the Boston Massacre for two reasons. One, the Boston Massacre, and through Attucks, we are able to see a little bit of early America and understand that the struggle for colonial rights was really only one of three great struggles happening at that moment.
Right.
There was also a struggle of those in bondage to be free, and there was a struggle on the part of Native peoples to recover some semblance of their own sovereignty, right? So
right.
Attucks gives us a window onto that world. But the other thing that Attucks does is he reminds us of the power of memory. So Attucks is really not a central figure to how people think about the Boston Massacre until the 1840s and the 1850s, when he's elevated as the central figure in the Boston Massacre by Black abolitionists. And
oh, wow.
why do they want to point to Crispus Attucks? Well, they're engaged in an argument with slaveholders and their allies who are saying, well, you can't end slavery because everybody knows that Black people can't be free because you can't make them into citizens. And if they can't be citizens, yeah. where would they fit in? And they can't be citizens because they can't sacrifice on behalf of the common good. And so the Black abolitionists are like, can't sacrifice on behalf of the country? Like, maybe you haven't met our friend Crispus over here, right? So they elevate him. You know, the first Boston Massacre anniversary after the Dred Scott decision in 1858, in which the Supreme Court said, yeah, in fact, African Americans can't be citizens. Black abolitionists organize here in Boston a Crispus Attucks Day celebration, in which they use the anniversary of the Boston Massacre to give unbelievably forward-thinking speeches
right.
about racial justice. And then he's used by civil rights leaders in the 20th century as a touchstone for that ongoing conversation about equity and racial justice. So Attucks reminds us that when we're remembering the founding of America, we're not just
right.
talking about our history. We're talking about who we think is in the circle of We the People today. And we're talking about who we are and who we want to be, right? So that's, you know, we're about as a nation to embark upon this arc of remembering that will culminate in 2026 with the 250th anniversary of independence.
Right.
And we wanted to ask our audiences to think with us about, okay, well, if that's what we're doing, what is the story we want to tell for this generation? And how can it help us to be the country we want to be?
Okay, great. Great. Thank you so much for being on the show today. I really, really appreciate that. Do you have any last thoughts you want to, I mean, you've done really well. You were talking about, you're afraid you're going to talk too much. And I was like, don't worry about that. I can ring you in.
Well, but you've done a good job of reining me in, Sandy. Thank you.
Do you have any last thoughts for anybody out there? Maybe anything?
Well, you know, I mean, yeah, I've got lots of last thoughts, but no, thank you so much for having me on. And I, you know, one idea to leave people with, I often say to our staff and to our visitors that if I could only accomplish one thing in giving people an experience of the founding era, it would be to help them understand why when somebody says, the founders said, or the founders thought, the only correct response is to say, oh, well, which founders, right? And I think that matters. It matters to how we think of ourselves today, because we often feel despondent over the fact that our country is divided, but we're divided over a set of questions we've been divided over all the way back to the revolutionary period. It is the through line in America, right? We argue about these things, and that's part of what sustains us. Sure. So we should not fall victim to imagining that somehow the revolutionary generation had it all figured out. They were arguing too, and there were some founders who got what they wanted, and there were some who felt like they had to keep fighting. And so here we are today, still arguing over these things. And you know, my goal is to share the past with people as a resource for continuing those conversations for tomorrow.
And the website is revolutionaryspaces.org.
You got it.
And Instagram, is it revspaces.org?
Yeah, at revspaces is our social media handle on Twitter and Instagram.
Great. Well, I'll put all of that in the show notes so that they can make sure and go to your page and join. You can actually join no matter where you are in the country.
That's right.
You can become a member.
And we hope many of your listeners will.
I agree. Okay. Thank you so much, Nat.
Thank you so much for having me.
There you have it, friends. What a fascinating conversation. I so appreciate Nat taking the time out to chat with me today. You can find out more about Revolutionary Spaces and how you can become a member at revolutionaryspaces.org and on social media at RevSpaces. You can find me on Instagram at A Southern Girl's View as well. If you're feeling extra special today, we would love if you snapped a screenshot of this episode and posted on your Instagram stories, tagging both Revolutionary Spaces and A Southern Girl's View, and let everyone know what you really enjoyed about this episode. If you want to leave us even more love, then hop on over to iTunes and leave us a 5-star review, or leave us a comment wherever you're listening to this podcast. You can watch the video version of this podcast on my website, asouthergirlsview.com. Until next time, have a fantastic rest of the day.